Today we're looking at classes of electrical conductor.
Sounds like I'm going back to school, Gordon.
You may well be. Stay tuned. We've got some fun tasks for Gary coming up. So people might ask, why we're making a video about class of conductor. What we're actually going to look at is how conductors are made up in terms of how many strands of copper are in there. And that's quite important when we return in some future videos to our favourite topic of ferrules.
Okay, so we're going to look at class 1, class 2, class 5 and class 6 conductors and their construction and what makes them those classes.
Yeah, now, everyone knows I love a part number nearly as much as I love a standard, and there's nothing like delving into the subtle language they put in a standard. And conductors themselves are covered in BSEN 60228 if you're watching from the UK, and that is a derivative of an international standard, which is IEC 60228.
Thank you very much for clearing that up for us. I'll go and delve into those after this video.
Yeah, so you know, what do we mean in terms of the class? So the class basically refers to how many strands of copper make up that conductor, and the diameter and the number of strands and the resistance of the conductor are all defined in that standard. You probably never ever read it, but you do see it. Now I'll flip ahead there. You do see it if you ever look at a cable manufacturer's data sheet.
Okay, so I can see there that is a class 1 or class 2. So I take it that when we go above 2.5 in twin and earth cables, it becomes solid stranded. That's the point at which it would be classed then as class 2.
Yeah, and then obviously I flick through, and then obviously flexible cables are always class 5.
Okay.
And you'll see them, and obviously that's all types of flexible cable. And not to leave our friends out in the security industry, burglar alarm cable is also covered in that as well, Gary.
Okay, all right, that's good. Are we going to start off by just having a little hand cam look at a class 1 conductor then?
Let's have a little closer look. And obviously, okay, people have seen these time and time again. It's incredibly common. Interestingly, this one here, you'd think it was 2.5. It's actually a 4mm conductor.
Yeah, and that was taken out of an MYY cable where the conductors in there say solid copper for a lot larger than we're used to in the UK, don't they?
Again, bringing the slide, the classification. Obviously, class 1 is solid conductors, as we said. Class 2 is stranded conductors, but both class 1 and class 2 are suitable for use in fixed wiring, wiring you'd find in a building. And class 5 is a flexible conductor, as we said. And class 6...
I think I had a little bit of input on this one. Class 6 conductors are more flexible than class 5, just a little bit more flexible. So I think you could argue I had an input there, because that makes logical sense to me.
Or in real world words, they're very flexible. Yeah. And you'll come across them probably in your daily lives in your test leads. And the wire that connects up your multifunction tester. So I think, Gary, the first thing, just can you count how many conductors are in there?
There's 7, Gordon. Yeah, and this, we often use this as our earthing conductor. Yeah, so there's 7 conductors in there, making it a little bit more flexible for that fixed wiring situation. We've also got some tails down there, and we've got a few more conductors in those, haven't we?
We have. Let's have a look at that. So again, so this is Doncaster maker, a more flexible version of a meter tail. And obviously that has more individual strands in it, but it is still a class 2 conductor.
Right, okay. So that's clear that we're comfortable, I would imagine, in the electrical industry, seeing regularly class 1 and class 2 conductors. Sometimes we don't notice where we see class 5 and class 6. Are we going to class 5 next?
Yeah, let's have a look at, well, we stripped open a class 5, so let's have a look at what's in there, Gary.
Okay, so here we go. So when we did this, we used our Wecon stripper. We've done a review on that on the channel, haven't we?
We have, it's gone down incredibly well. So this is a tri-rated cable, so you find panel wiring, things like that, where most people would probably see it.
Okay, we'll also identify where we've got it on the desk as well at some point, where we actually see it more often than we think. So there we go. So that was our fine stranded class 5 conductor.
Yeah, so I think, Gary, probably what it'd be really useful to know how many strands are in that, actually, in that conductor. So. I think you best just can you just count them up? I mean, you did so well on the 7 core. I think really be you know, don't want to shortchange you, you know. Meanwhile he's doing that, I'll just have a little catch up on the old coffee. How was that, Gary?
Terrific. Absolutely terrific.
So how many strands were in there?
Well, as long as I haven't lost any in the journey over to the chair, I got to 122 strands.
That's a lot of strands. More than I thought would have been in there.
Well, I counted them, so yeah, 122.
Yeah, 100. So that's a tri-rated cable, but obviously that's same class 5 conductors are used in flexible cables. Obviously, the bigger the cables, there tends to be more individual strands in there. And the maximum diameter of those strands is defined in our regulation. So if I just flick through to that there, you will see that in a class 5 conductor, the 16 millimeter one there, you're indeed right, Gary. There was a lot of conductors. So it doesn't actually tell you in the standard how many conductors have to be in there, but it does tell you the maximum diameter that those can be. And it also defines the resistance of the cable.
Right, okay, so yeah, there's lots of information then that probably we wouldn't be, you know, day-to-day electricians bothered about, but it's actually setting the standards, which is really obviously interesting from this.
Yeah, so next, Gary, I think we should open up a class 6 conductor. So
right, okay.
Let's have a little look inside one of them. So again, get the Wecon stripper out.
Got to be really careful with these because they're so finely stranded, obviously, when you're dragging down with that blade that you don't catch any of them because there'll be lost a few in there else. So let's see how well you did. So we open that up. Okay, there is a lot of, there's a lot of strands in there. Also, little mini bundles as well within that cable, Gordon, yeah?
Yeah.
There we go.
Again, it almost feels like they're so fine, it almost feels like it could be a paintbrush, like that. And yeah, I mean, I wonder how many more, you know, the class 5, I wonder how many more conductors are in a class 6, I think. Well, since you did well on the 7, you did well on the 5. Off you trot.
With a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10, I can count way up to 10. Let's sing the song again.
How was that?
Oh yeah, great, terrific. I had a whale of a time.
You'll be pleased to know, Gary, there isn't a class 7.
Great. Okay.
Yeah, so interesting. How many do you find in there?
I got to 504, but there is always a chance that one or two of them may have gone missing in the process.
Well, that's good, Gary. So again, if we return to our standard, so the standard again for that 16 millimetre, they are a maximum of 0.21 millimetres each.
Right.
And again, it doesn't define how many make up that conductor, but it does define the maximum resistance you have.
Okay, so set on the resistance.
Yeah. Now, a little trick. Yeah, some people might say that. We did a video a while ago that looked at fake and substandard cables, and the cable we found in there, someone had probably shortchanged the customer and the amount of copper that was in there, didn't they?
They did, so there wasn't as many strands as maybe expected. So if you've got 504 to go at, if you missed 10 out, would anyone really know?
Exactly. Okay. Yeah, so watch for that one. If you want a quality control check, send the cable through to Gary. He'll happily count them for you and send it back. But obviously the way to check is the resistance of the cable, because that is defined in the standard, that if you've got a 16 millimeter cable, its maximum resistance should not be more than 1.2 ohms per kilometer if it's a class 5 or class 6 conductor.
All right, that's nice to know then. So that should be checked by the manufacturer, shouldn't it? So
yeah,
down to those.
Yeah, we saw that Doncaster scale. They've got a lab that does all those things. Now, interestingly, flexible conductor is actually got just a slightly higher resistance than solid conductors.
Right, so can I just have a little closer look as you explain that to me? Standard class 2, one that we're very familiar with using, actually looks thinner than the class 5 and class 6 conductors.
Yeah, and you're exactly right, Gary. There's a millimetre difference in the diameter between these, the class 2 and the class 5 and 6 conductors.
Right, okay. So again, when you're feeling around and you've perhaps gone into a DB and you start feeling those tails from main switches and that could be class 5 or class 6, you tend to think they're a little bit bigger, don't you?
Yeah, now again, that's defined in the standard. If we have a quick look at there, obviously if we had a solid conductor, that would be smaller again.
Right.
So it'd be 4.6 millimetres. The class 2 is 5.3 and the class 5 and 6 are 6.3.
And they're all the diameters, yeah?
That's all diameters, yeah. All the same cross-sectional area for obviously current carrying capacity, things like that. But if we look at our friend a ferrule here, Gary, this is where it comes in, because this is a ferrule that's suitable for a 16 millimeter cable.
Right.
You see it.
Oh, well, that's loose.
Rattles around on there. Whereas if we put it on there,
it's gonna be a challenge.
Challenge there, because the insulated one there, that's got a very
right.
Snug fit to it. and we'll revisit that when we look at the topic of ferrules on these different conductor types.
Yeah, so we're going to look at the class of cables, and we're going to look whether or not we can or can't ferrule them.
Yeah.
That'll be interesting, won't it?
It will. So where else might you see them in common life? So we had a little dig around at some of the electrical apparatus. So sometimes you'll see a class of cable mentioned. Obviously, we show it on the cable conductor size itself. Sometimes you'll see it on switch gear and things like that. But let's have a look at common ones where manufacturers use it. So here's something we pulled out of a Luden consumer unit. You can see that is
really flexible. So I'm going for six on that class six conductor.
Definitely. I mean, you'll look at if we just peel back the silicon insulation there, you can see that's definitely a class six.
But I also took the RCBO out of the same board, this one here.
Yeah.
And that seemed a little stiffer.
Yeah, again, so I think that's a class five. And then if you get in close there, Gary, you can see there's some, you can almost, you could probably count those strands.
I won't be.
Yeah, so that looks like, class five. But then we had a little look at the latest AFDD technology, this Wilex one here. And again, you get close now, they've ultrasonically welded the end instead of using a ferrule. But when you get in close.
Yeah.
You can see.
And you can tell it is very, very flexible, is it? And as they say in the standards, it's class six is more flexible than class five, okay? Which is, I like them sort of. That's really flexible.
That's floppy. Probably why this is more expensive.
It's absolutely nothing to do with that. It's all those super electronics that are in there.
Check out the video we made on that where I actually take that to bits. And I think you can actually see the conductor in there when we do that. So,
So that's where you're going to see them. So when you used to make it off a consumer unit, so you wouldn't say, necessarily in that consumer unit I've got class one, I've got class two, but actually you've got potentially five and six depending on the manufacturer as well. So Gordon's worked hard to dig his way through the standards, and I'd like to suggest I've worked really hard counting up to really large numbers. Thank you, Gordon. But as always, we want your feedback, especially in this area. Is there something that you're an expert on within this field you'd like to add to the comments? Is there somebody asking a question that you know the answer to, and can you help them with that answer? We'd really appreciate that type of feedback, and we will also try and get back to as many comments as we can.